Every member of this committee and saying our thoughts and prayers are with the people of Oklahoma. We will stand with the courageous community of Moore, with the people of Oklahoma, as they come together to face this tragedy. May we stand together as citizens of the United States of America with the people of Moore and with the people of Oklahoma. We're all together. We all share their grief. The statesman Adlai Stevenson once said, and I'm quoting him now, "The government by consent of the governed is the most difficult of all, because it depends for its success and viability on the good judgments of so many of us." These words are etched in granite at the IRS headquarters just outside Washington, D.C. They speak to the need for government at all levels to exercise sound judgment in order to earn and keep the confidence of the American people. That confidence was broken recently by the news that the IRS targeted conservative groups seeking tax-exempt status. In doing so, the IRS abandoned good judgment and lost the public's trust. The American people have every right to be outraged. Targeting groups based on their political views is not only inappropriate, it is intolerable. We need to understand how and why this targeting occurred. We need to know who was involved and who was responsible. We need to install new safeguards to ensure this targeting never happens again. The IRS has one of the most direct relationships with Americans of any agency in our government. IRS employees know where we live, where we work, how many children we have, and what investments we make. Because of this, IRS employees are placed in a position of great trust. And they must exercise this trust in a fair and even-handed manner. Employees, the tax-exempt unit of the IRS office in Cincinnati, abuse this trust. The Treasury Inspector General's report found that employees in this unit targeted groups with names containing Tea Party, Patriot, and other terms associated with conservatives. The Inspector General's report also found that the tax-exempt unit was a bureaucratic mess. Employees were ignorant about tax laws, defiant of their supervisors, and blind to the appearance of impropriety. This is unacceptable. But the Inspector General's report also raises many unanswered questions. For example, the report examined 298 applications, and the Cincinnati IRS office reportedly identified 96 of those 298 applications using political screening terms. But what was the nature of the other 202 applications? Were they filed by liberal groups, moderate groups, or groups that had no political affiliation? We can't measure the full impact of this case without knowing the nature of these additional applications. And who was responsible? We know the IRS officials in Washington tried to stop this behavior, but who in Cincinnati perpetuated this behavior? One person? Two people? The whole office? Who? We don't know. Not yet. I intend to get to the bottom of what happened. As part of our oversight of the IRS, this committee has launched a formal bipartisan investigation. We have requested additional documents from the IRS as part of our independent inquiry. We will follow the facts and see where they take us. The Inspector General's report also demonstrates the need for Congress and this committee to review and reform the nation's tax laws when it comes to 501c4 organizations. We have come a long way from the Tariff Act of 1894, when Congress first created exemptions for charitable, religious, and educational organizations. Today, there are countless political organizations at both ends of the spectrum masquerading as social welfare groups in order to skirt the tax code. These groups seek 501c4 tax-exempt status. Why? Because it allows them to engage in political activity while keeping the identity of their donors secret. According to data collected by the website opensecrets.org, 501c4s spent $254 million in the 2012 election. That's about equal to the combined spending of the 2012 Democratic Republican political parties. None of the donors behind these multi-million dollar campaigns were disclosed. This was all secret money. In 2010, I wrote a letter to the IRS asking them to look at all major tax-exempt organizations, 501c4s, c5s, and c6s. I asked this question: is a tax code being used to eliminate transparency in the funding of our elections, elections that are constitutional bedrock of our democracy? This letter was part of a long line of investigations that the Senate Finance Committee has conducted into nonprofit tax-exempt organizations. In 2006, we investigated the office efforts of Jack Abramoff to use nonprofits to lobby Congress. And in 2005, when Senator Grassley was chairman of this committee, we investigated religious organizations, nonprofit hospitals, and the Nature Conservancy. Once the smoke of the current controversy clears, we need to examine the root of this issue and reform the nation's vague 501c4 tax laws. Neither the tax code nor the complex regulations that govern nonprofits provide clear standards for how much political activity a 501c4 group can undertake. The code does not even provide a clear definition of what qualifies as political activity. And the statute provides one definition of 501c4, while IRS regulations say something different. The statute says its contributions or earnings must be, quote, devoted exclusively to charitable, educational, or recreational purposes, end quote. The key word being exclusively. IRS regulations, on the other hand, define the 501c4s as organizations, quote, primarily, not exclusively, primarily engaged in promoting in some way the common good and general welfare of the people of the community. How does the IRS justify regulations that weaken the standard from exclusively to primarily? These ambiguities may have contributed to the IRS taking the unacceptable steps you're examining here today. Americans expect the IRS to do its job without passion or prejudice. The IRS can't pick one group for closer examination and give others a free pass. But that is apparently what they did. As Adlai Stevenson said, the success of our government depends on the good judgments of so many. It is clear that many in the IRS exercise poor judgment in this case. Today, we'll have to answer for it. Sir Hatch.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I begin, I would like to just take a moment to say that my thoughts and prayers are with the good people of Oklahoma who have been impacted by yesterday's devastating tornadoes. In particular, my prayers go out to those who have lost loved ones. Really catastrophic storms, and I hope they're going to be able to deal with this tragedy in every good way. Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for convening this important hearing. You and I do not always agree on all of the issues, but on this point we agree. Despite some claims to the contrary, the IRS targeting of citizens for their political views is in fact a scandal. It determines Americans' trust, it undermines Americans' trust that their government will enforce the law without regard to political beliefs or party affiliation. Make no mistake, this hearing and the investigation that will follow are absolutely critical to this country. Over the weekend, a senior White House official said, Republicans are on a, quote, a partisan fishing expedition, unquote, and that we are conducting, quote, trumped-up hearings, unquote. I hope they're not referring to what this committee is doing or to this hearing that we are having today. This would be very disconcerting, particularly after last week when the President said he was committed to working with Congress to find out the truth. These hearings are not some sideshow designed to distract from the President's agenda. I hope that the President and his administration are not attempting to distract us from getting to the bottom of this. This committee is going to pursue this matter wherever it leads. The Internal Revenue Service is one of the most powerful agencies in our government. Everybody knows that. It has a broader reach than almost any other government agency or entity. Indeed, many law-abiding Americans are already afraid of the IRS. That being the case, the American people have a right to expect that the IRS will exercise its authority in a neutral, non-biased way. We need to work together to make sure that this is precisely what it does. Any hint of political bias or partisanship at the IRS needs to be taken seriously. Sadly, as we'll discuss during today's hearing, there appears to have been more than a hint of political bias in the IRS's processing of applications of groups applying for tax-exempt status. We have a report from the Treasury Inspector General for Tax Administration, or TIGTA, indicating that the use of inappropriate political criteria was all too common in the evaluation of these applications. So far, here's what we know. We know that between 2010 and 2012, conservative groups applying for tax-exempt status were targeted by the IRS and subjected to increased levels of scrutiny. We know that these groups were targeted because they had the words, quote, Tea Party, unquote, or, quote, Patriots, unquote, etc., in their name because they said in their applications that they wanted to do things like, quote, make America a better place to live, unquote. We know that these conservative groups were asked invasive and inappropriate questions about their donors, their positions on various issues, and the political affiliations of their officers and directors. We know that some of these groups' applications were delayed for more than 3 years, even as applications for groups friendly to the president and liberal causes were promptly approved. We know that, despite some early claims to the contrary, knowledge of this operation extended beyond the processing center in Cincinnati, and that IRS officials in Washington, D.C. were aware of the program at an early stage. We have also seen evidence that employees in other IRS offices besides Cincinnati scrutinized conservative organizations to an unreasonable degree. In spite of what the IRS has said publicly, it has become clear that this problem was not limited to a few employees in Cincinnati. And we know that by June 2012, at the latest, the number two official at the Department of Treasury, Deputy Secretary Neil Wolin, was aware that there was an ongoing TIGTA inquiry into these issues. Here's what we don't know. We don't know why the targeting began. We are concerned about the extent to which senior officials at the IRS and Department of Treasury became aware of these practices, when they found out, and what they did or did not do to put a stop to them. And perhaps most important, we want to know why the IRS purposefully misled Congress when they led us to believe that no groups were being targeted when we repeatedly raised this issue with the agency last year. This, to me, is one of the most disturbing elements of this story. On multiple occasions in 2012, I spearheaded letters from Republican senators to the then IRS Commissioner Shulman, asking questions about the IRS's processing of applicants for tax-exempt status and the reports that the process had become politicized. I received two separate responses from Acting Commissioner Stephen Miller, who was at that time serving as the Deputy Commissioner for Services and Enforcement. Neither of these responses even hinted at the possibility that the targeting was going on, even though these officials in Washington were certainly aware that a number of conservative groups had, in fact, been targeted. Indeed, despite multiple efforts during the 2012 election campaign to find out the facts about this targeting program, the IRS did not decide to come clean until the release of the TIGTA report was imminent and their hand was forced. And even then, one of the top IRS officials, in consultation with the Department of Treasury, chose to disclose that it had targeted innocent organizations by responding to a planted question at a press conference. A planted question. The American people deserve to know the truth about what went on here, and they deserve to know why the truth was kept from them for so long. Were the top IRS officials willfully blind to what was going on, or were they simply holding out until after the election? While the targeting of conservative groups in the review process has received most of the attention thus far, it's not the only problem that needs to be addressed. I am, of course, referring to the fact that in 2012, one of the IRS offices that were targeting conservative groups' applications also improperly disclosed confidential information about some of the same groups to a left-leaning media organization called ProPublica. This revelation comes on the heels of other allegations that the IRS disclosed to activist groups and media outlets confidential information, including donor information, submitted by conservative nonprofits. We need to look closely at all these allegations as well. So as you can see, Mr. Chairman, there are a lot of problems at the IRS. I'm glad that, thus far, members of both parties have recognized the need to address these issues. Mr. Chairman, I'm pleased to be working with you on this investigation, and I hope that we'll continue to work together on a bipartisan basis to get to the bottom of all this. I want to assure our colleagues and the American people that we're going to find out exactly what happened here, and we're going to do everything we can to make sure it doesn't happen again. The only way to fully address these issues and to restore the credibility of the IRS is to have a full accounting of the facts. And one way or another, we're going to learn the facts about what went on here. I hope that we can do so with the full and complete cooperation of the Obama administration. Today's hearing is just the first step in this process. I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Sir Hatch. I'd now like to welcome our panel of witnesses. First, the Honorable Russell George, Treasury Inspector General for Tax Administration at the United States Department of Treasury. Second, Mr. Stephen Miller, Acting Commissioner of the Internal Revenue Service here in Washington, D.C. And third, former Commissioner of the IRS, the Honorable Douglas Shulman. Thank you all for coming. Before we begin, I'd like you all to stand so I can swear you in, please.